And he arrived at my house just after he got engaged, and it's all he could talk about, this wonderful woman, and how happy he was, and it made me sick. Part of what's so boring was he spent the whole time with his mobile phone clamped to his ear, talking and talking and talking to this woman, Twitter, staggeringly named drivel that spoke, endless detail. Went on for hours a day, but what was interesting was at the end of every single conversation, no matter what they'd said, the last three words he said to her were always the same. Just before he put the phone down, he always said, "I love you." All that drivel, but right at the end, the only three words that matter, "I love you." And it's quite a good principle. It's apparently we forget 90% of everything that's said to us in every conversation. Did you know that? Just your eyes made that up. Sounds convincing. I can see you were with me there, weren't you? You were with me. But we forget a lot of what's said to us anyway, so it's a good idea. If you want someone to remember something you said, make it the last thing you say to them before saying goodbye. Those last words are what they're most likely to remember. And that makes the Bible passage that's just been read to us all the more important, because these are the very last words that Jesus speaks to the disciples before he ascends to be with the Father. The last thing he says before he goes back to heaven. And what are those last words? What does he most want them to remember? He says, "Go and make disciples." That's how important that command is. Go and make disciples. Why is this commandment so vitally important? It'd make life so much easier if Jesus had never said that, wouldn't it? If it said, "All right, that's the gospel, but keep it to yourselves, eh?" That would be so much easier. We wouldn't need Vision 2026, save so much time. We could spend tonight at home sipping vintage champagne, eating lobster. That's what Bishop Julian does on his night out. Strategies, clever ideas, courses, videos, resources. There's millions of them. But we forget the why. Why are we doing this? Why is that command so important? Well, of course, it's because of the jewel that is ours. We live in a culture which is facing a massive crisis of purpose. People live frenetically busy lives. They rush around, earning money and spending it. They engage in leisure activities which are just as driven and as manic as their work. They're so, so busy, so driven. And a lot of this drivenness is there because they're running away from a question. They've forgotten what it's for. They've forgotten what life is about. And lurking behind it all is the ultimate human fear. The fear that all of this is meaningless, that life actually has no significance at all, that all we're confronting is annihilation and non-existence. What's it about? What is life for? And of course, that's the question that we can answer as Christians, because we know that life has no purpose whatsoever except in relationship with Jesus Christ. We know that life is indeed pointless, except because of his love. Raised from the dust, raised from nothingness, Christ, through his cross, lifts us up to glory. So we've been set free by the cross, set free from sin, set free from death. But this isn't just about freedom from, it's also about freedom to. We've been set free to realize our potential, set free to be the people God calls us to be, set free to see the true beauty of the people in our lives in this wonderful world, set free to live forever, set free above all to live each and every day in a contemporary relationship with the most wonderful, beautiful person who ever lived, with Jesus Christ. My friends, that gift is yours. That new life is yours. How on earth can we possibly think to keep it to ourselves? What greed is that? What sin is that, not to want to share this good news? Of course you must make disciples. Of course we have to go out and obey that command, because we know the purpose of life. We can help people discover what they're for. Benedict XVI, the last pope, once wrote, "To evangelize is to teach the art of living." That is our vocation, to show the world how to be alive, because life only has meaning in relationship with Jesus Christ. But we can't do that. We can't share what we haven't got. Our techniques, our vision, our evangelism will come to nothing unless they are an expression of our own joyful life in Christ. And that's why, from tonight, we're sending you away to pray, sending you away for a year of prayer and preparation. So go from this place to pray for your parish, that you might know how best to respond to Vision 2026. Go from this place to pray for your diocese, taking this bold step of planning not for decline, but for growth. Go from this place, above all, simply to pray, because it's through prayer that Christ comes more and more to life within us. It's through prayer that we become more and more aware of his love and glory, and so can share the hope that is within us. Go, make disciples of all nations, Jesus says. Go, make disciples of all Lancashire, Jesus is saying to us. So first of all, go and pray.